To lift the ceiling off of what we have believed that we are. And Lord, we come into alignment with how you see us, God, in the name of Jesus. I am a child of God. I am a child of God. I am a child of God. What I felt when Jen popped this on me, she said she was going to preach for 10 minutes, and you know, you did pretty good. Yeah, you did really good. In fact, both of you kind of stole my sermon, so, you know, I do have some complaints, but I mean, that's okay. But what I felt like the Lord was saying, I said, Lord, what particular, like I can speak on identity for 3 weeks. And I said, what particularly is fashion for this group today? And I felt like the Lord is saying, there's something that he showed me last summer. And it was to do with agreement. Because you see, it's not important what we believe. It's important what he believes. And we have fought and we have contended with what we believe all our life. And we are sticking to our beliefs. But what if we shifted into what he believes? What if we started to believe what God believes? What if we started? Is there a difference between, you see, the thing of it is I've grown up a lot in my Christian life and my belief has shifted and shifted and shifted. But I know this, that God never shifts. He never changes. There's no shadow of turning with him. So somehow, if I'm going to believe the truth, I'm going to have to line up with how he believes. And so the thing of it is we've been taught a lot of stuff. We've been taught a lot of things that I believe are erroneous. And for you that don't understand what erroneous means, is full of errors. Okay, Jen, that was for you.
Thank you, darling.
Okay, so it's just trying to be a blessing. Yeah. Okay, all right. So, you see, what God created us to be is one of the most powerful forces. Well, we are the most powerful force on the earth. Okay, so let's get over our unpowerful part of us, because that is not how he sees us. And for some reason, he thought it was a good idea to dwell in us. You know, and what are we doing? We have looked at ourselves, we have put ourselves down, we have said, I am not worthy, I am this, I am that, etc. And yet, the most highest being of the entire universe says, I come up with a great plan, I'm going to dwell in them. Like to us, we think we're a dirty stable. But you know what? We're not. I asked God one time, I said, Lord, what is it like living inside of us? And he said, you're my Caribbean vacation. So why do we feel that God is so disgusted with us? Because there's an alignment that needs to take place. And what the Lord was saying to me today is that the next period, the next stage that we're entering into right now is a stage of coming into agreement with God. And okay, so here's Jesus. Jesus teaches us how to pray in Matthew chapter 6. And he says this, Our Father who art in heaven. First of all, that should give us an indication of identity. Okay, first of all, he said, Our Father. Jesus didn't say, my father. He said, our father, which art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Holy is your name. And then he said, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. So you see, here's God. God is a visible God. An invisible God, but God wanted a representation on the earth of what he was like, so he created you. And he said, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What does Paul say that we are? We are citizens of heaven. But even Jesus, let's go to John chapter 17. somewhere. Just go where the Lord is showing you, and you'll find it. John 17. I don't know if I wrote it down or not, but we'll wing it. So John chapter 17. Do you have John 17? Yeah, it's coming. Where's it coming from? Okay. You know, this is going to take forever. It's John chapter 17. Okay, let's go down to verse 20, I think it is. Wait a minute. Hold that thought. Okay. Come on. Okay. John 17. Yeah, I know. Hold. You're on hold. Is this the number to whom I'm calling? One ringy dingy, two ringy dingies. Okay. How many ever watched Lily Tomlin? She was one of my favorite. Yes. Okay. Good. Okay. So we're on the same train. And so here's what he said, verse 14. Okay. Verse 14, he says, I have given them my word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Okay? So first of all, the first thing we need to erase is the fact that we're not from here. Okay? You were not from here. When were you ever from here? Never. Okay? So in other words, what God does is he says we are a representation of heaven on the earth. So what happens when he said, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, is when we get a hold of the fact that I am a child of God, we get a hold of the fact that here I am walking on the earth right now, and when I come into agreement with God for who I am, I come into agreement with God, here's the prayer, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So what it does is through my presence, through your agreement in who you say, in who God says that you are, his will gets done. It's agreement. Because there's something that God set in place before the foundation of the world, and it was this. Agreement, the power of agreement. He says, if any two of you agree as touching anything, so shall it be established. Okay, so I want us to go back and understand that the Satan himself knew that principle. You see, Psalm 8, some kind of a psalm, it says, the heavens are the heavens of the Lord, but the earth he has given to all humanity. So the heavens are the heavens of the Lord, but the earth is Psalm 115, verse 16. He says, the heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth he has given to all humanity. And so what happens is we are his ruling force on the earth. When did he change his mind about that? He can't change his mind. This is where we've got to understand. I am the Lord, and I change not. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. The same. And then James says, coming down from the Father of lights, in him there is no shadow of turning. He will never change. And so when it says the heavens are the heavens of the Lord, but the earth he's given to all humanity. Why? Because in God's mind, the invisible God rules the heavens, but the visible demonstration of who he is on the earth. Guess who that is? Yeah. And when we come to a place, as Jen was singing this morning, and I felt the Spirit of the Lord just come on the place when we stood up and agreed with heaven. I am a child of God. Okay? When we come into agreement on the earth, okay, I'm not a sinner who has Jesus in my heart. I'm sorry, that identity is false. Because what you're saying by that is that Satan's power to deceive and lead us into sin is greater than what God's opinion is of who we are. Because as far as I'm concerned, sin does not have the power that God has. And so we need to come out of agreement with the power of sin. We need to come out of agreement with how, you know, one time I asked God, and it was at these, as he was revealing this identity to me, and I said to him, God, are we forever going to be known as the people that botched it for you? Are we forever going to be known? Because we go around with the identity, sinners saved by grace. What is that? That's a stigma. That's a stigma that we fell. It's a stigma that we're not lining up and we are falling short of the glory of God. I thought Jesus took care of that. You know, I really do. So what it does is it puts a focus on us. We think it's humble. It's crap. Okay? You know, I tried to, when I was in Panama, my interpreter, I said, it's crap. And she says, I'm not saying that. She's not interpreting that into Spanish. I said, okay, it's caca. And then they all understood it, so it was great. And so this is the thing. It is wrong. Because you see, when we get the alignment of how heaven sees us, there's something about the agreement. I am a child of God. I am a child of God. That's who he says that I am. Okay? I am a child of God. In fact, I believe we're always children of God. Because we were created in his image and in his likeness. When did we lose that? We only lost it in our mind. We only lost that in our mind. And I could go into 3 weeks of teaching you why I believe that. Because I believe that if God created you a certain way, number one, I'm going to ask you this morning, were you created a sinner? Well, then that's not how he sees you. You were not created a sinner. In Genesis chapter 1, when he just said he created man in his own image. If we're created a sinner, then God's a sinner. Hello? Okay? So there's some erroneous things that we have to erase. There's some erroneous things that we have to erase. Why? Because we haven't... You see what happened in the Garden of Eden? Satan came in, and what is Satan? What did Eve call Satan? A deceiver. So how do you think we have picked up his nature? It's not God's nature. We picked up his nature. The old nature, that fallen nature, is not God's nature. And let me tell you this, it is not your nature. It's a false nature. It's a nature, it was almost like a cloak. It was almost like a costume that was put on us. It was given, it was like a role. This guy by the name of Satan was the greatest director of a play that there ever was. And he fed us the lines that we say. He fed us our role. He fed us how we act, etc. And he said, this is your role, act in it. That's the old nature. But what if we just took the cloak off? What Jesus did, he broke the power of that delusion so that we could uncloak who we really are. Sin had to be paid for. But let me ask you this. Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, it says, the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. So, I'm going to ask you a question. Are you ready? Okay. So, if the price was paid before you were created, Okay, it was already in the bank, right? Okay, and then all of a sudden we fell into sin. But the price for it was in the bank. Did God intend for you to be punished? No. Okay? You see that? We were so incredibly valuable to God. He saw through the time that man would fall into sin before we were created. And Jesus Christ was slain, it says, before the foundation of the world. So if we grab a hold of that identity and realize that we were so incredibly valuable to God that he would send his son, and the son had decided before the foundation of the world that we were valuable. Why? Because when God looks at you, here's another thought. Is there evil in heaven?
No.
She's smart. Okay, then how can God have an evil thought towards you? Okay? In fact, the Bible says in John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, have everlasting life. Verse 17 is, for God sent not his Son into the world to what? Oh, wait a minute. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world. As far as he was concerned, the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world took the condemnation. Okay, Romans chapter it's either 12 or 8 or somewhere in there. It says, there is therefore now no condemnation. So God is not condemning us. Why? Because what he sees is his original plan. What he sees is the original you. What he sees is how he made us. And what the enemy has done, by the way, the enemy has come and distorted our thinking. And we started believing stuff that was not God's character, but his character. Okay? Your old nature is actually not the real you. It never was. It never was. Paul, don't believe me. Go to Romans chapter 7, verse 17. Romans chapter 7, verse 17, and then we're going to do Romans chapter 7, verse 20 as well. Anybody have the complete Jewish Bible? You got the Tree of Life? What kind of a Bible is that? Okay, try it. Look it up on Romans 7, 17 there, Sam. I'll tell you whether we need to... Okay. Okay.
That nothing good dwells in me that is in my flesh.
Okay, sorry. So now it is no longer I doing it, but sin dwelling in me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is in my flesh. For to will is to present in me, but to do the good is not. For the good that I want to do, not that I do not do, but the evil that I do not want. This I practice. But if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I doing it, but sin that dwells in me.
Hello. Do you see that? Yep. Do you see what God was doing there? He was separating us, the real us, from the sin. He was just saying, okay, for instance, Vic, you had your nurse, right? Okay, so we have this patient, and she's got pneumococcal pneumonia, right? Okay, she's in room 33 down the hall. Is that person pneumococcal pneumonia? No. It's a diagnosis. It's not the real person. So why are we embracing the sinner identity? So why are we embracing the sinner identity? And the reason is that is a person that is suffering with pneumococcal pneumonia. We are all suffering with something called sin. Okay, but it's not the real us. And it's not how, like, okay, if you're a mother, Duck. Okay, so say that, Eddie, okay, is sick. Okay, he's sick in bed. So do you walk in the room and go, hello, pneumococcal pneumonia? No. But we've embraced an identity. And we've confessed an identity that God has never. He doesn't look at you and say, oh, there's my little sinner coming now. See, I feel that what God wants to do is God wants us to come into alignment, into agreement. Because you see, what happened is the enemy knew he could not get God's dominion in the heavens. So he came up with a plan to get the dominion on the earth. Well, who has the dominion on the earth? We do. Okay? The only way that he could get the dominion on the earth is to trick us into coming into agreement with him. Okay? Because of the power of agreement. If any two of you agree, so shall it be established. And so what he did in the Garden of Eden, he caused us to come into an agreement with him. And so his kingdom started getting set up. But what if we came out of agreement? What if this day, when we leave this place, we stopped agreeing that we're no longer sinners saved by grace? What if we walked out of this building knowing that God is not condemning us? He doesn't have one condemning word. He can't have a condemning word because there's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Like, what if we walked out of agreement here, out of agreement? What if we stood, I am a child of God. I am a child of God. And what if God is doing this on the earth right now for the greatest move ever? Have you ever wondered why identity is coming on the scene right now and you're hearing it everywhere? Why? Because God is setting up the biggest victory ever was. Because what is happening is the enemy is getting troubled because his plan and his plot has been exposed. Okay? And what happens is we come into agreement with God for who God says that we are, and watch out. The minute you come into agreement with God, things fall off of you. I'm telling you, this message of identity, what it's done with me is I wake up in peace. I don't wake up with the shoulda, coulda, wouldas. I don't wake up with biting my holy fingernails because I should have done this, I shouldn't have done that. And walking around with gloom, despair, and agony on me. Deep, dark depression, excessive misery. I don't wake up with that. But I'll tell you, before I was a slave, before I thought it was the things that I did that made me acceptable to God, it was behavior-oriented. But I found out I am a child of God. And as Jen says, he just loves me. Period. Stick a fork in it. That's done. When your child misbehaved, did you lose love for them? Why do we think God is different? Why do we think God is up there? Well, that's it. I'm done with that kid. Rotten brat. Okay, why do we feel that way? That God is up there measuring how we are accepted by our behavior? because of deception. I learned this. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life. So I want you to think about this for a minute. If you're trying to earn something for God, it's a wage. If you're forcing yourself to do things like reading the Bible, devotions, I'm not saying they're wrong, but I'm just saying if that's what's making you feel accepted to God, acceptable to God, then you're earning a wage. But everything about God is a gift. It's a gift. God is a giver. Even the fact that you believe in Him is because He gave you the gift to believe. You didn't believe on your own. He gave you that gift. And so when you were baptized in the Holy Spirit, a gift. It says the gift of the Holy Spirit. Everything's a gift, gift, gift. Every revelation you get, every revelation that God has given me, I know it's a gift. I didn't earn it. It's a gift. Because we have a good, good Father. That's who He is. He's a giver. I remember listening to a Game Changer teaching, and the teaching said that this guy was deliberately acting like a moron and acting not good as a good Christian. He was an idiot. And he was actually purposely trying to get God mad. And God kept loving him, and God kept giving him favor. And he says, why are you doing that? And God says, Graham, you can't change who I am. This is just who I am. So what has happened is, we have put God in a box and expect Him to treat us like a human being would treat us. But God is not human. He's God. When will He ever not be good? When will He ever not be kind? When will He ever not be loving towards us? When? He is who He is. We just don't know Him. And because we've been mistreated and rejected, we think He does that. And because in this world we're trying to earn favors, we're trying to earn respect, we're trying to earn everything else, we think God is like that too. And He's not. He's good. He's just good. He's so full of love. There is never a moment. I'm telling you this. If God is up here and He's looking down towards you and you are doing something wrong, did the love tap get turned off? No, it still comes to us. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. It never comes to an end. What if we started agreeing with heaven? What if we began to agree that this is what God is like? His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is Your faithfulness, O Lord. Great is Your faithfulness. So what if we came into agreement with God? I heard the word synchronization. My own testimony is this. I remember someone saying about the desire of your heart. And because God gives you desire, Jen talked about us coming into a time of coming, and I believe Ann did too, about coming into a place where we're ready to get into a ministry and into what God has created us to be. Why? Because there's a sense of agreement with heaven when that happens. You know? And it's because, first of all, I have to get rid of the fluff that I believed about me so that I can come into agreement with what God believes about me. And so they asked me, they said, this person, asked, what are you doing? What do you think God is calling you to do? I have never lived in a time of my life with the sense of fulfillment that I have right now. And the reason is I believe that I am aligned with heaven, of how heaven sees me. Now, am I perfectly understanding everything? No. But I have come into it as I get more and more revelation of who God is, and actually more and more revelation about me. What happens? Favor. Open doors. It's amazing. It's amazing because we have struggled. We all have struggled with rejection issues. We have all struggled with a poor, low self-esteem, etc. But you know what? There's no need for it. There's no need for it. Because God has such a high opinion. But the enemy, the deceiver, has tried to convince us otherwise. So what if that mentality of being a failure, I'm a failure for Jesus, I've got the gift of failing, thank you Jesus, amen. Yeah. And then some of us have grown up because we're so used to condemnation, we think we have the ministry of condemnation. Thank you, Jesus, I got that gift, amen. I practice it all the time. It's powerful in the name of Jesus. I can make the worst Christian feel condemned. Yes, amen. I got that ministry. Judge, judge, judge. That's what I do. I'm the judge. You come to judge. Don't snort. That's us. She snort. So, but what if we came into agreement with the Lord about who he says that we are? You know, I think we've arrived at this point. Let's go to Exodus chapter 14. Exodus chapter 14. Who's snorting over there? Oh, yeah, way to go, girls. Okay, Exodus chapter 14. And let's read verses 15 to 16. Now, the history of this is this. Okay, the children of Israel have left Egypt. They're crossing the desert towards the Red Sea, and they have arrived at the shore of the Red Sea. Okay, and the Egyptian army is coming towards them, okay, but what's in front of them is the Red Sea. Okay, so they knew that they were in a time and a challenge for them, their lives. And so this is what it says. When Israel faced the Red Sea, God promised that they would never see the Egyptian armies ever again. And he says, that which is behind you is already defeated. Okay, I want to say this very clearly. That which is behind you is already defeated. Okay, What if we think that which is behind us is still alive? We're going to go into tribulation. We're going to go into nervousness. We're going to go into defeat. We're going to go into all this kind of stuff. But what God said to Moses that day, he said, that which is behind you is already defeated. It's already defeated. So, and then verse 15, he said this, and this is where the body of Christ, the church, is at right now. Verse 15, and here's God saying this to Moses. Why are you crying out to me, Moses? Use your staff. Why are you crying out to me, Moses? You've been entitled as a child of God. You've been entitled with favor as a child of God. You have the authority of the Most High God. You represent heaven on earth. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And he says, why are you crying out to me? Why are you crying out to me right now? Rise up and do what you're called to do. Rise up and use that authority and stand before and part that sea wide open. Why are you crying out to me? And as long as we're crying out to God, and as long as we're in that victim mentality, and as long as we're in that defeated position, we cannot part the sea in front of us. But I believe what God is doing on the earth right now in the body of Christ is we have raised up to a time when we're going to cross over and we're going to have victory in the name of Jesus, because we know who we are. We know who we are. And we're looking at what happened with the U.S. election on the 8th of November. That was us crossing the Red Sea. That was us crossing the Red Sea. Why? Because it's time for the church to rise up, grow up, know who we are, and cross the sea. But I'm telling you, if we think the enemy behind us that has caused all this stuff to happen at us, and as long as we maintain a victim mentality, we're not going to go anywhere. Because the enemy is constantly going to remind us that we cannot do it. But this loving Father is saying, you're my child. There's nothing impossible with you. There's nothing. Speak to that sea and walk across it. If you can't part it, walk on it. Here's Jesus. He's out on the Sea of Galilee. He's sleepy. So he falls asleep. And the disciples, they're in the boat too, but they forgot that Jesus is also in the same boat, okay? And they're crying, we're going to perish, we're going to perish. Don't you care that we're going to perish? Well, if you could sink Jesus, they could be sunk. Come on! Where is Christ? He's in us. He's in our boat. And if you can sink Jesus, you can be sunk. But can you sink Jesus? Then why do we think we can be defeated? What if we believed what God believed? Jesus stood up and said, you of little faith. They needed to grow up. And so there's some things that we're facing right now. There might be some struggles that you're dealing with right now. What if God is saying, stand up and hold up your staff? The Bible says, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. The Bible says also in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, he says, God will always lead us to triumph. You know, it's funny because, it was two nights ago or last night or sometime, and Steve Mayange was being prophesied over here by Dave. And Steve was sitting here, and in the Spirit of the Lord was all over what Dave was saying. But God was showing me something about Steve Mayange. And he was actually teaching me at the moment. And he said, we think that all the gifts that God has been listed in that Bible. But God's a creative God. He is creating gifts all the time. And I felt like the Lord, tell Steve, I'm about ready to release a gift to him. And I said, Lord, what is that gift? So I walked over to Steve afterwards and I said, I feel like the Lord is giving you a gift that he has just created. And it's the gift of triumph. I said, not only will you be a winner, you will triumph. It's much bigger than just winning. Because you can win if it's 5-4. Okay? But you can triumph when it's 20-1. And that's what I felt like the Lord was saying. I am bestowing, I'm creating new gifts right now. I am creating new gifts all the time. And we can walk in those gifts. And I felt like that's what God wants to do. Why? Because we had time to spend with him in the lobby over at the Come On In. We were over there. And I'm telling you, this guy's got identity down to a T. And he quoted this scripture. I want to quote it to you. Let's go to Psalm 8. That's just before Psalm 9. Seriously. If you've gone to Psalm 10, you've gone too far. Okay, Psalm 8 is somewhere. I wrote it down. I don't know where it is. Okay, what do you have? Yeah, it's all good. Just read it all. It's what is man? Start with that verse and read that.
What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? You made him lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands and you put everything under his feet.
Okay. Oh, good.
Okay.
So what is man that you're mindful of him? The son of man. And it says you've made him just a little lower than the angels, right? Well, actually, you know what that word is translated? It's actually not a correct translation. Because it is you have made him a little lower than Elohim. Which is? So, here we have God. Okay, and this is another proof of it. When Jesus was dying on the cross, it says he could have commanded the angels. Okay, so he's saying the Son of Man is made a little lower than the angels. That's a wrong translation. Because Jesus had authority over the angels. And so here we have this translation that said, what is man? We're made just a little lower than God. Acts chapter 17, verse 28, I believe, says this. In him we live and move and have our being. And as some of your poets have said, we are his offspring. The word offspring means we have his genes. We have his DNA. I am a child of God. How much, like Jen said, her boys come into the house. Mom! I am a child of God. Are you all right, Jen? Did I wake you up? I thought maybe she was sleeping, you know, but she's okay. So, I am a child of God. We are made just a little lower. But we're heaven citizens on the earth. When we fulfill and walk in what God says that we are, watch out. All authority, Jesus said, I have all authority in heaven and earth, and I have given you authority. Okay, and here's another thing. Marilyn, I need you. Yes. So, Jesus, he's the head, right? Right? He's the head? The Bible says he's the head. Paul says he's the head. Who's the body? We are. Okay, but only the favor comes on the head. Okay, and the body is not favored, right? Okay, wait. Only the head is holy.
No, because it couldn't possibly be, because everything is connected and interconnected.
Right on. Okay.
The same gene, the same gene count, you know, the same chromosome count, the same DNA is right. here.
Okay, so if I take a blood sample from the head and a blood sample from the ankle? Yeah.
Will it be the same?
Same blood. Okay, good.
Is that all you need me for?
Yeah. Would you sit down now, please? Okay. Okay. And so here we are. We're looking at the difference. What we've done is it says we've been taught more about God being with us. Actually, it's even, it's in us. But Jesus said a prayer in John 17 that makes us one. He says, Father, I'm in you, you're in me. They are going to be in us. We're one. What if we... Wait a minute. We're one with him. He's not walking with us. That was not the highest desire that God had, was to walk with us. God wanted to walk as us. That's why he created us in his own image and his own likeness. That we would fully, he's not nervous about his reputation. That we would be fully made in his image and we represent him on the earth as it is in heaven. We are the visible likeness of God. The only people that do not see that is us. But what God is doing is he's unveiling. He's unveiling who we really are. And all the damage that was done to us, that brutalized us, that made us feel rejected, that made us feel worthless, that made us feel, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Slaves, I am a child of God. God is revealing right now and setting us free. If there's something that you're feeling unworthy, not measuring up, not quite attaining, that's a wage. It's not the heart of God. He knew we couldn't take care of the sin thing, but Jesus did it. Everything that was wrong with us was crucified 2,000 years ago on the cross. Everything that was wrong with us is gone. As far as the east is from the west. What if we lived like there was nothing wrong with us? I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Let's just stand. Father, we